Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
On this morning, I'd like for us to take a look at the book of Matthew. Grab your copy of God's Divine Word. I typically read out of the New King James Version of your Bible. Matthew chapter number 9. And we want to look at verse number 9 through verse number 13. I want to reiterate the text that had been read into your hearing moments ago. And then we will go from there. We've got a powerful word from the Lord on this morning that I pray will be of substantive value to all of us. Matthew chapter number 9. Verse number 9 through 13. Listen to your Bible. The Bible says, as Jesus passed on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax office. And he said to him, follow me. Amen. So he arose and followed him. Now it happened as Jesus sat at the table in the house, that behold, many tax collectors and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples. Verse number 11, and when the Pharisees saw it, they said to his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? When Jesus heard that, he said to them, those who are well have no need for a physician. But those who are sick, verse number 13, but go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice. For I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Wherever you may be, let all those who believe and agree say amen. For a few moments on this morning, I'd like for us to consider for a subject, who let you in? Who let you in? When we look at this particular text, we see that Matthew was called by Jesus the Christ. Matthew was in his business as a tax collector. Amen. And Jesus comes along and simply says, follow me. I want us to recognize that tax collectors were not thought of in high regard. Matthew, being a Jew, a Jewish man, working for the Roman government, collecting taxes on behalf of the Roman government, was often seen as a betrayer of his own people. For many tax collectors could charge you more than you really owed in taxes, and the difference would go in the tax collector's pocket. And so many in the community saw tax collectors in a very negative light. They wanted to have nothing to do with tax collectors. And so here is Matthew, and he's at his job at the tax office. And Jesus comes along and says, follow me. I want us to notice what takes place from this juncture forward. That's going to be very important in our understanding on this morning. This particular account is correlated with the writings of Mark and also of Luke. The same event that takes place was written by Matthew, it was written by Mark, and it was also documented by Dr. Luke. When we look over in Matthew chapter, chapter 2, verse 13 and 17, Mark parallels the writing of Matthew very closely. But in Mark's account, he uses the name Levi. Matthew and Levi, we're talking about the same individual. And so when we look at the life of Matthew, the life of Levi, again, we're talking about the same individual. When we look over in Luke chapter number 5, and I'd like for you to go there for just a moment. In Luke chapter number 5, down there around verse number 28. The Bible lets us know at this same account that we read in Matthew chapter number 9, Luke records a little bit more information than Matthew and Mark record in this particular respect. In verse number 28, listen to your Bible. After Jesus calls Matthew, or Levi as he is called, the Bible lets us know in verse number 28 of Luke 5, the Bible says, so he left all, rose up, and followed him. Here he is in his business, and he leaves his business elated, excited, thrilled that the Lord would call him to be one of his disciples and soon to be apostles of King and Christ Jesus. He was elated about that, so much so that when we look in verse number 29, listen to your Bible. In verse number 29, the Bible says, then Levi gave him, that is Jesus, a great feast in his own house. And that's what I want us to key in on, that Matthew or Levi was so excited that he throws a feast for Jesus in his own house. Now, when we consider this subject, who let you in? And we see the comments of the Pharisees, and the Pharisees asking Jesus' disciples, amen, does your teacher, or why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? Oftentimes, when you look at that passage and you don't study it really quickly, the first thing you will think is, what are these tax collectors and sinners doing here? Amen. I want us to understand that our subject, who let you in, is not about the tax collectors and the sinners, but our subject really deals with the Pharisees. In other words, what are you doing here? When we think about the Pharisees were a group of religious Jews that were notorious for their strict adherence to the law of Moses. The name or the term Pharisees literally meant, amen, separated ones. And so these Pharisees that were strict followers of the law of Moses, they separated themselves, as all Jews did, from Gentiles. They separated themselves from sinners and, amen, those undesirables even among the Jewish nation. They even separated themselves from ordinary Jews, because ordinary Jews did not strictly keep the law of Moses. And it was as if, amen, they would be guilty by association, by spending time with those who may be in sin, because they are not strict or in the observant of the law of Moses. But one of the character flaws and problems that we found with the Pharisees is the fact that they love the praises of men more than the praises of God. When we look at the Pharisees, Jesus condemns them and has negative, negative toward this group of men in Matthew 23, around verse number 27, Jesus called the Pharisees hypocrites. He called them, amen, because their hearts didn't match up with their outward appearance. They loved to wear the long robes, the regalia, that if, even if you looked in a crowd and a mile away, you can discern a Pharisee from an ordinary Jew because of their regalia, because of how they carried themselves. But the problem is, inward did not match outward. And so Jesus called them hypocrites. He said, you are like whitewashed tombs, which appear beautiful on the outward appearance, but inward you're full of dead men's bones. And so the Pharisees, amen, were notorious for being hard on others while seeing themselves as self-righteous. When we look at Romans chapter 3 and verse number 10, the Bible lets us know that there's none righteous, no, not one. And so we have to understand that only God is righteous, but the child of God becomes the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And so the only way we can be right is to be in King and Christ Jesus. But let's look a little bit closer, closer to the Pharisees, their disposition, what they believe, how they carried themselves, how they saw themselves. Turn with me, if you will, to Luke chapter number 18 and verse number 9 and following. in Luke chapter number 18, verse number 9 and following. I want us to get a better understanding of the worldview or the mindset of the Pharisees. And these are they that came to a tax collector's house. Those who they despise. In other words, who let you in? If you're so holy, if you are so pure, if you are so perfect, what are you doing at a tax collector's house? And have the audacity, the unmitigated gall, to question Jesus being invited to the tax collector's house. So we have to look at this. In Luke chapter number 18 and verse number 9 and following, listen to your Bible. The Bible reads thus. Also Jesus spoke a parable. He says, to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous. These are the Pharisees. And not only did they see themselves as righteous, scripture lets us know that they despise others. In verse number 10, Jesus begins his parable. He says, two men went up to pray, to the temple to pray. One a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. Listen to the disposition of the Pharisee. The Bible says the Pharisee stood, not bowed down, not prostrated on the ground, but the Pharisee stood and prayed thus within himself. Listen to what the Pharisee thinks about himself. He says, God, I thank you that I'm not like other men. I'm better than everybody else. Amen. Extortioners, unjust, adulterers. Amen. Or even as this tax collector. It's hard to read this text, amen, and not feel some kind of way about modern Pharisees, those that see themselves, amen, better than God, amen. We have some modern Pharisees today, but these Pharisees here, amen, were glad that they were not like nobody else, at least in their mind, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. He said, I fast twice a week. I got to be better than everybody else. I give tithes of all that I possess. I got to be better than everybody else. And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Jesus said, I'll tell you, this man went to his house justified rather than the other, the Pharisee. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. And so this gives us a little flavor, a little feel about the disposition of the Pharisees, those who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and had the audacity to despise others. Turn your Bible to Luke chapter number 7. In Luke chapter number 7 and verse number 36 and following. In Luke chapter 7, verse 36 and following. Here's another occasion. And on this particular occasion, Jesus is invited to a Pharisee's house. But listen to your Bible. Verse number 36. Then one of the Pharisees asked Jesus him to eat with him. And he went to the Pharisee's house and sat down to eat. And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil and stood at Jesus' feet behind him weeping. And she began to wash his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. And she kissed his feet and anointed them with the fragrant oil. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he spoke thus within himself, saying, this man, talking about Jesus, if he were a prophet, would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner. Here's a woman at the Pharisee's house, laden down with guilt and feeling some kind of way about life and rejected, dejected. She hears about the Lord and she doesn't even bring her problems to the Lord, but she comes to anoint his feet. She comes, amen, to cry on the Lord. She doesn't even face him. She comes up behind him. But the disposition of the Pharisee is that this woman is a sinner, and not only is she a sinner, but if Jesus is who he declares himself to be, he would know that she's a sinner. I want us to understand that one of the things the Pharisee did not know, although he thought he knew all about this woman, is that he did not know the one that he invited to the dinner. He did not know Jesus. And many people today, the self-righteous that live among the community, who think that they, amen, are better than God. Amen. It's ironic that these are the same folk that don't know God like they claim to know God. Just because you got a hallelujah, just because you got to praise the Lord, just because you got a God is good, does not mean that you're better than somebody else. Does not mean, amen, that you got it together. Many folk who think they know the Lord don't know the Lord as they think they do. And so when we begin to examine Jesus, find out who he is, apparently the Pharisees did not know. When we look at Matthew chapter number 11 and verse 28 through 30. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 through 30. Listen to Jesus. He's going to tell you a little bit about him for those who think they know the Lord. Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." He says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle," or some of your Bible said, "meek and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." If you want to try to get to know Jesus, you need to know that he is meek. You need to know that he is gentle. You need to know that he is humble or lowly. And so many people fail to understand the nature of the God they profess that they know. When we turn the page and go just a little bit further to Hebrews chapter 4 and verse number 15, let's try to see if we can get to know who this Jesus really is. In Hebrews chapter number 4 and verse number 15, listen to your Bible. The Bible says, "For we do not have a high priest." Jesus is our high priest. Listen to the Hebrew writer. "For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin." And so we've got a high priest in Jesus the Christ, our Lord. Amen. Who can sympathize with us. In other words, although he's without sin, amen, he, amen, is not out of touch. He's not too high to sympathize. He understands when you got folk that smile in your face and stab you in the back. He understands when folk are plotting against you. He understands when folk that you thought were friends betrayed you. And so Jesus walked the dusty roads of Palestine. He lived 33 years on this here earth. He understands man. Amen. Not only because he's all knowing, but he understands man experientially. In other words, he felt man and saw man. He knows how man thinks. Amen. And so he can sympathize with us because he knows what we're dealing with when you deal with old wretched man that I am. Aren't you glad that we have a high priest that can identify with what we're going through? He experienced everything that we experience, yet without sin. And it is because of this, in Philippians chapter number 2, verse 5 through 8, that Paul writes this prison epistle. And Paul says about Jesus in Philippians 2 and verse 5 and following, Paul says, watch it, "Let this mind be in you." In other words, we have to dawn on the mind of Christ. There are many folk that claim to know the Lord that don't dawn on the mind of Christ because they don't really know the Lord. In Philippians 2 and verse number 5 and following, the Hebrew Paul says, "Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men." And amen. "And being found in the appearance as a man," here it come, "he," that is Christ, "humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross." And so when we talk about knowing who Jesus is, he's humble. He's lowly. Amen. And so we have to understand who it is that we are dealing with. Apparently, the Pharisee who saw themselves as better than everyone else did not know God as they claimed themselves to have known. And so when we think about Jesus, who is God in the flesh, in Psalm 18 and 30, the Bible lets us know that he's perfect in all his ways. Amen. If Jesus were a golfer, y'all, amen, he would get a hole in one every time he teed up. If Jesus were a basketball player, every time he shot a shot, it would go in nothing but net. If Jesus were a dart player, you know, the little dart board and you throw your dart, he would hit a bullseye every time. And so I want us to understand that Jesus, our Savior, is perfect in all his ways. And although he's perfect, look at Hebrews chapter 7 and verse number 26. I want us to understand that although he's perfect, he's got time for you and I. He loves folk that are not perfect. He understands that we got some brokenness. He understands we got some habits and some hang-ups. And so where the Pharisees would have nothing to do with regular old man, Jesus, amen, positioned himself among those that needed him most. Jesus told the Pharisees that I did not come to call the righteous or so-called righteous, but I came to call sinners. And so it's important that we understand that we have a condition that's called sin, the virus of sin. And Jesus wants us to understand, amen, that those that are well have no need of a physician. How many of us can identify with needing a physician? How many of us know that if it had not been for the Lord, where would I be even unto this day? And so when we look at Hebrews chapter number 7 and verse number 26, I want us to know something else about our Lord. The Bible says, for such a high priest, talking about Jesus, was fitting for you and I, or fitting for us, who is, Jesus is, watch it, he's holy, he's harmless, he, Jesus, is undefiled, he is separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens. And so it's important that we understand comparatively Jesus, our high priest, amen, and how so much superior he is than the high priest of his own day and prior. The high priest of old would have to offer up sacrifices for himself and for the people, amen, because he was not perfect himself in all his regalia. But we have a high priest, Jesus, our Savior, amen, who is perfect in all his ways. And so what is the point here? I want us to understand that those who are in the church today are just like those that were in Levi's house. When we think about Levi or Matthew's house, those tax collectors and sinners, I want you to know that the church is full of people that got problems. Amen. But I want us to understand the difference is we've got a Savior, a great physician, Jesus, that can help us in our time of need. And so when we look over in 1 Corinthians chapter number 6, in 1 Corinthians chapter number 6, verse 9 and following, I want to share with us and help us to identify with the fact that those who are in the Lord's house are much like those that were in Matthew's house. But it's only the self-righteous that see those who got problems and issues and hang-ups as less than and themselves better than. In 1 Corinthians chapter number 6 and verse number 9 and following, listen to the Apostle Paul write, amen, to the saints that are in Corinth. Paul says, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Watch it. Here it come. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. Here it come. And such were some of you. Amen. All of us have come from some place. Amen. All of us have had some dirt that needed to be washed away. And so Paul says, but you were washed. Praise the Lord, saint. You miss your shout. You were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of God. Yes, we were a whole lot of things. But when we discovered Jesus and understood and obeyed the gospel, God working with us and through us enabled and helped us to overcome and put away the old man. But we must identify with those who were in Levi's house. Amen. Because those who were in Levi's house are the same those that are in the house of God. When we think about Jesus, we have many types of the Lord in the Old Testament. Amen. A type of Christ, Isaac, a type of Christ. But one of the types of Christ who comparatively is much like Jesus is a man by the name of David. And in 1 Samuel chapter 22, in 1 Samuel chapter 22, I want us to notice something in particular about David and those around David, who is a man after God's own heart. In 1 Samuel chapter 22 and verse number 1 and 2, listen to your Bible. The Bible reads thus, David therefore departed from there, the Bible says, and escaped to the cave of Adullam. So when his brothers and all his father's house heard it, they went down there to him. The Bible says in verse number 2, here it come. And everyone who was in distress, everyone who was in debt, and everyone who was discontented gathered to him, that is David. So he became captain over them, and there were about 400 men with him. I want us to understand that David had a whole lot of folk that got issues that were with David, a man after God's own heart, while he was running from Saul. He had folk that were in distress. There are folk like that in the church today that are going through trouble, trials, and tribulation. He had folk that were in debt. There are folk in the church today that are in debt, but thank God for Jesus. He had folk that were discontented. Thank God we got Jesus and can learn about contentment even in the midst of our distress. And so those in the Lord's house are much like those who were in the cave of Adullam. 400 men that were with David, who was a type of Christ. Those who were in the church were those that Paul was writing about, who were in Corinth, who were formerly thieves and murderers and, homosexuals and adulterers and sodomites and all of these kinds of things. We are no better than these folk that were in Levi's house. And so with that being said, our subject, who let you in? The question is, with Jesus being who he is, holy, undefiled, separate from sinners, perfect because he is God, who let you in to his kingdom? Why and how in the world can people like us be associated with the purity of God? How in the world can people like us with trouble, trials, and tribulations be considered holy in Christ Jesus, be considered the righteousness of God? I want us to understand that there are many people today who are in the world that do not believe that they are eligible to eternal life with Christ because they see themselves as too bad. I'm not good enough to become a Christian. I want you to understand that eternal life is wholly accessible to everyone. Doesn't matter what you have done. Doesn't matter what your past entails. Amen. Jesus had brought salvation down, and everyone has an opportunity to the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. It's important that we understand everybody's eligible for eternal life. Don't sit there and think that only good folk can go to heaven. Everybody in the church have got some issues. And so when you look at John 10 and verse number 9, Jesus says, I am the door. I am the door. I'm the access point. If you're going to get in Christ, you have to come through Jesus. I want us to think about pole vaulting. Pole vaulting, I was looking it up and thinking about a few metaphors to communicate my points on this morning. In the Netherlands, centuries ago, poles were used as a practical means to cross natural obstacles. And so they would take a long pole and they would use a pole to cross, for instance, a river. And so they would pole vault across the river. But I want us to understand that since the 1800s, pole vaulting has become, amen, an Olympic sport in which it is added to the Olympics, and men and women are into pole vaulting. I want us to understand that this is a metaphor for us today. Now, number one, when you think about pole vaulting, you have two uprights. And in pole vaulting, those two uprights are called standards. Standards. The two uprights are called standards. I want us to recognize that Jesus is our standard. And we have to wrap our heads around the fact that Jesus is our standard. He's our standard in word, and he's our standard in deed. And so when you think about a standard in word and in deed, this is who Jesus really is. When we look over in Luke chapter number 7, in Luke chapter number 7, and you drop down to verse number 19, I want us to understand that Jesus is the standard, and the standard is, amen, too high for us to cross over. But Jesus is the standard. Bear in mind our pole vaulting metaphor. In Luke chapter 7, verse 19 through 23, follow with me in your Bible. The Bible says, and John, calling two of his disciples to him, sent them to Jesus, saying, are you the coming one, or do we look for another? Look at verse number 20. He says, when the men had come to him, that is Jesus, they said, John the Baptist has sent us to you, saying, are you the coming one, or do we look for another? Verse 21, and that hour he, that is Jesus, cured many infirmities, afflictions, and evil spirits, and to many blind he gave sight. Jesus answered and said to them, go tell John the things you have, watch it, seen and heard. We're talking about the standard. Jesus is the standard in what we have seen in terms of what he have done and heard in terms of what he said. And so Jesus is perfect in action and he's perfect in words. He told them to go, amen, and tell John the things that you have seen and heard. I want you to be a witness. Go tell John what you saw. What did you see? The blind see. The lame walk. Lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the poor have the gospel preached to them, and the blessed, and blessed is he who is not offended because of me. Well, if Jesus is the standard, what is it about Jesus? Again, everything he did and everything he said is the standard, and that standard is too high for us to cross over. Nevertheless, he did for us what we could not do for ourselves. Let's look at these standards of Jesus. Acts chapter number 1. And Acts chapter number 1 and verse number 1. Listen to your Bible. Acts chapter 1 and verse number 1. Listen to your Bible. Dr. Luke writes. Luke wrote two books of the New Testament. He wrote the book of Luke. And he also wrote the book of Acts. The Acts of the Apostles. In Acts chapter number 1 and verse number 1. Listen to your Bible. The former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that what? Jesus began what? Both to do and to teach. And so he's writing this book right here to let us, Theophilus, to know the things that Jesus both did and taught. Amen. Jesus is the standard. Turn your Bible, if you will, to 1 John. 1 John chapter 1 and verse number 1 through 3. 1 John chapter 1 and verse number 1 through 3. Jesus is the standards. Listen to your Bible. John says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our own eyes, and which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life. When he talks about word of life, he's talking about Jesus himself. Verse number 2, the light was manifest, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifest to us. John is a witness. Verse 3, that which we have seen. You can't be a witness if you hadn't seen anything. And heard. He's a witness because he saw the things that Jesus did and he heard the things that Jesus taught. John says, we declare to you that you also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus the Christ. And so what are you saying? I'm saying in our pole vaulting metaphor that Jesus is these two uprights. He's the standard based on what he have done and based on what he have, said. Now then, somehow we've got to get in the door, and the uprights are too high for us to get over. I want us to understand that while the standard is high, the bar is low. The bar is low enough for you and I to pole vault over and into King and Christ Jesus. I want us to understand that the runner, that would be the individual. Amen. In order for you to pole vault into Christ, amen, you're going to need the pole. And the pole is the word of God. And I want us to understand that the word of God will enable you, amen, to overcome your circumstances. And the word of God will enable you to overcome your sin. And so when you think about the pole, amen, and I've got to get into Christ. Christ is the standard, but I can't get that high. But the bar is low enough for me to get through. Amen, but I need the word of God to overcome my circumstances. Some people have difficulty coming to Christ because of their past circumstances. And in addition to circumstances, many people have difficulty coming to Christ because of their sin. And they not thinking that they're good enough to come into Christ. But when you study the word of God and you grab hold of the pole and you're ready to pole vault into the Lord, I want you to know that the word of God enables us to cross over bad relationships. The word of God enables us to pole vault over bad habits. Enables us to, amen, heal from brokenheartedness. Enables us to, amen, recognize that it doesn't matter what other people think, those bad habits. Enable us to get over some false beliefs or bad beliefs that we have had. It enables us, the word of God, amen, to cross over, amen, various forms of abuse. Why? That I might enter into the church or the beloved of God. So I want us to understand that it doesn't matter what is before you. If you got the word of God and if Christ is the door, amen, you can pole vault over, amen, whatever it is that is hindering you from becoming a child of God, knowing that I can't reach as high as the standard, but Jesus set the bar low enough for me to come to Christ, become a child of the Most High God. And so I think that's very important for us to understand, because many people see themselves as ineligible, but God has made a way for us to, amen, join with a perfect God, even with our imperfections. And so when you look at Luke chapter number 24, and Luke chapter number 24 and verse number 46 and following, the Bible says, listen to Jesus. Then he said to them, thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer. He suffered for the reason. He suffered that you might become a child of God. To suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. And that, here come, repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations beginning at Jerusalem. The gospel is good news because it doesn't matter where you came from or what you've done in the past. Only in Christ can we have access to repentance and remission or forgiveness of sins. And you need to understand that because there are many people who have yet to come to Christ because they do not see themselves as good as other people. I want us to understand that the Pharisees are those types of people. And the question is, again, who let you in? Since you see yourself so perfect, what are you doing in the company of Jesus? If you know that you've got some hangups and hiccups, if you know that you're not perfect, if you know that you need a savior, Jesus wants you in the house. Lastly, I'm going to tell you about an individual that ended up in the house who you didn't think would be in the house. Look at Acts chapter number 8 as we haste to a close. In Acts chapter number 8, verse number 9, listen to your Bible. The Bible reads, Acts 8 and 9, "But there was a certain man called Simon who previously practiced sorcery." He is a sorcerer. What's he going to do ending up in the church? One of those call me now, one of those soothsayers, one of those folk that are beguiling and deceiving folk. What is this guy going to do in the church? How does the church have people like this in the body of Christ? I want us to understand everybody, amen, is somebody and can be a child of God. Listen to your Bible. "But there was a certain man called Simon who previously practiced sorcery in the city and astonished the people of Samaria, claiming that he was somebody great, to whom all gave heed from the least to the greatest, saying, 'This man is the great power of God.'" This is what they were saying about this sorcerer by the name of Simon. This man is the power of God. Simon had been doing miraculous things, fooling folk for a long time. But the Bible lets us know in verse number 11, "And they heeded him because he had astonished them with his sorceries for a long time." Verse 12, "But when they believed Philip," the man of God, "Philip, as he preached the things concerning the kingdom of God," the kingdom is the church, and the church is the kingdom. When Philip preached the things concerning the kingdom of God or the church of our Lord, the Bible says, "and the name of Jesus Christ." So he taught them about the body of Christ or the church, and he taught them about Jesus. In order to get in the church, you've got to come through Jesus. So you've got to know about Jesus. And so he taught them about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ. Both men and women were what? Baptized. Follow the story. "Then Simon himself also believed." It's amazing. Doesn't matter what you've been into. Doesn't matter if you had a 40-year prison sentence. Doesn't matter where you have come from. Doesn't matter your harlotry. Doesn't matter if you're a victim of sex trafficking. Doesn't matter what kind of shame and what kind of attachment was to your name. You can become a child of God. Simon was, and you can too. "And so Simon himself also believed when he was baptized, continued with Philip, and was amazed seeing the miracles and signs that were done." Well, when you read down a little bit further, the apostles come down to Samaria and they begin to impart by the laying on of hands a miraculous spiritual gift among the people. And Simon saw the manifestation of the miraculous gift that was being imparted to disciples or children of God. Perhaps somebody can all of a sudden speak in a different language. Perhaps somebody can interpret in a different language. Perhaps somebody could prophesy. And so he saw these miraculous workings of the Holy Spirit as a result of the laying on of hands of the apostles. And then Simon, because guess what? Even in the church, you're still not perfect. You still got some of those past ways. The Bible lets us know that Simon had approached Peter in verse number 18. Listen to verse number 18, Acts 8. The Bible says, "And when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands, the Holy Spirit was given, he offered them money." See, Simon thought that this is the way things work in the world. You're supposed to give money for everything. Amen. Give money for this, give money for that, and all kinds of stuff. Can I get the power of the Holy Spirit? He was still new in the Lord and had a worldly mindset. And so the Bible lets us know in verse number 19, saying, give me this power that anyone on whom I lay hands may receive the Holy Spirit. Listen to Peter, verse number 20. Peter says, amen, your money perish with you. I want you to understand there's some things money can't buy. Amen, you can't buy your way into heaven. Amen, you can't buy forgiveness. Amen, doesn't matter your bank account. It doesn't make you somebody in the Lord, but this is his mindset. He's a child of God yet, but he still has a worldly mindset. He still has to grow. He still has to evolve. He still has to learn. He still has to be taught. So the Bible said, Peter says, your money perish with you, amen, because you thought, verse 20, of course, that the gift of God could be purchased with money. In verse number 21, he says, you have neither part nor portion in this matter, for your heart is not right in the sight of God. Well, what did he have to do now? He got himself in trouble with that worldly mindset. In verse number 22, Peter says, repent. See, now that he's a child of God, he has the privilege to go to God and ask God for forgiveness. When you become a child of God and you sin again, because you will, nobody's perfect, and we have to strive to do what's right, but every now and then you're going to find yourself out of line. You have the privilege, because you are a child of the Most High God, to do what Peter said, repent. He said, therefore, of this your wickedness, and pray God if perhaps the thought of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are poisoned by bitterness and bound with iniquity. Simon speaks, the sorcerer, in verse 24. He says, pray to the Lord for me, that none of these things which you have spoken may come upon me. I want us to understand that Jesus died that repentance and remission of sins may be accessible to us. The door is open and Jesus is the door. You don't have to be Jesus to get into Christ. He's the door. The bar has been lowered. Doesn't matter if you are a thief. Doesn't matter if you are a murderer. Doesn't matter if you are a gossiper. Doesn't matter if you are a liar. You can come into Christ, and with the power of the Holy Spirit, God can work into you to be what you need to be. God does not qualify, amen, does not call the qualified, but God qualifies those that are called. And so he calls us while we're dirty. He calls us while we're a mess. He calls us while we are tore up from the floor up. And God says, you catch them, I'll clean them. Pass out the gospel. Tell men and women about the good news of Jesus Christ, and I will change their lives. You can become a child of God even on this morning. If Simon can become a child of God, you can become a child of God. If Matthew, a tax collector, amen, can be an apostle, you can be, amen, a disciple of Jesus Christ. If sinners were in the presence of the Lord, and in biblical days, to eat with someone is to have fellowship with someone, amen, Jesus was not afraid to go to places where people were rejected and considered the offscour of the world, and teach them the good news of Jesus Christ. I want us to know that God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. If you are with us on this morning and you want to become a child of God, amen, and you recognize that you're not self-righteous, you're not perfect, I want you to understand you are a candidate. And so the Bible lets us know, so then faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Romans 10, 17. All you have to do is hear the word of God. You have to hear that God's only begotten son, Jesus, our Savior, hung, bled, and died for your sin and for mine. But early one Sunday morning, he rose up with all power in his hand. Amen. And so he overcome hell, death, and the grave. He's our Savior, ascended to the right hand of the Father. And if you will obey the gospel by hearing who Jesus is, believing, amen, what he have accomplished for us on the cross, recognizing that all have sinned. And when I say all, it's not y'all, it's all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Understanding Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. Where is eternal life? In Christ Jesus. All you had to do is hear that message. You had to believe it with all your heart. Hebrews 11 and 6. You have to repent of your sin. All of us have done some wrong. Got to repent of your sin. Luke 13, 3. You must confess that Jesus is who he declared himself to be. Matthew 10, 32 and 33. And then you must be baptized for the remission of your sins. And when you do that, who let you in? Jesus let me in. Amen. You can't get in your way. You have to come the gospel way. And Jesus is the way. And everybody in the church is allowing God Almighty to help us to be what we need to be. Jesus is the bar. Jesus is the standard. But he's lowered the bar so that every man can be somebody in King in Christ Jesus. So we pray that something has been said to encourage our heart to recognize the love of God, in that he doesn't look down on us, but he wants to lift us up. And if you want to be lifted up, Jesus is, again, the way. And so if you want to become a child of God, you have to obey that gospel. We want to encourage you. We don't know where you are, and amen, and have yet to meet you, but we want you to know we want to assist you if you want to become a child of God. Give us a call at the Church of Christ in Goose Creek, South Carolina. We can be reached at 843-824-1217. You can also contact us via the website at www.goosecreekchurchofchrist.com. We want to minister to your spiritual needs. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God has one plan for all man, and everybody is eligible. And so if you want to become a child of God, we want to assist you in that endeavor. Contact the Church of Christ. We will call you back. We will teach the Word of God. Ask the questions that you have, the Bible questions, and we'll give you a Bible answer. And if becoming a child of God is your desire, we will baptize you into Christ. You will become my sister or my brother in Christ. You will become a child of the Most High God, and you can begin today anew. Today can be the first day of a new journey in Christ. Why don't you make that decision even at this hour?
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.